Fundamentals of software testing, terms and concepts. So let's talk about a bit of terms and concepts that are related to testing. Besides bugs and faults, there are also other terms that might have different meaning depending on who is speaking. So we have developers, we have a business person, we have customers, and they are speaking all their own languages. And then there are different terms are used in different phases of software development. So it's a different thing when you are starting a new software project, and then again you might be working with a 10-year-old software that is being still developed, and the customer does not meet all the concepts. He or she probably never sees what is unit testing, and on the other hand, the developer has not that much to do with the business model testing. So there are different worlds in software development and software testing. During software lifecycle, various test phases are gone through. But what is a software lifecycle? So let's check about that. Software project begins, and the first version is being written. So we probably release it somewhere around 1.0. And after that, if it's still improved, you get 1.1 and then 1.2 and 1.3, etc. And sometimes there is a reasons. There are reasons that the software needs to be rewritten. So new major version is built. We go from 1.0 to 2.0. And sometimes the software is just that old that you really don't need it anymore. So then it's disposed. And there might be cases that someone wants to use some old software that is unsupported, but it's not wise, so you don't want to use Windows XP anymore. And if you think about, let's say, Android, it uses this kind of a format. There was Android 1.0, 1.1, and then 2.0, and now we are somewhere around 11. And let's say we are changing our framework. We are changing from Qt 4 to Qt 5. So then software is somewhat built again because the framework in the background it's changed. So probably a lot of method calls are deprecated and new ones are brought to life. So we are building a new major version, and as the version number changes from 4.x to 5.0, this is what happened with, for example, with KDE when they changed from Qt 4 to Qt 5. And there are different testings conducted in different lifecycle stages, so it's different to test software that is just beginning, the project is beginning, then we are testing business models and these kind of things. But when we are doing minor versioning, then there are a lot of regression testing and these kind of things. But the business model, for example, is going as it was already. So in the previous video, we were talking about this V model. And then there are different testing terms, such as pre-testing, which is in-house testing with the pieces of software that might get into final product, or they might be discarded, or that, okay, this piece is not good, let's throw it away and let's develop something better. And it can lead to redesign of the product. So then we get to alpha testing. So it's done without customer in-house. So only the company developing the software is doing that testing. It's pretty much also with the let's say games. If you are developing a computer game, you do alpha testing in-house, and the aim is to answer question, does this product work? Then we go to beta testing, and then we have involved customer also there, and customer te do does testing but with help from the vendor, and the idea is to answer the question, does customer like the product? If customer doesn't like the product, then there is a lot of redesigning. But if he or she likes the product, then it's okay. And this is also with the gaming industry. You can play many of better versions of the games, and the vendor then gets new information from actual players. Then there is a field testing concepts where customer is doing testing and vendor is only monitoring. So the aim is to answer question, will customer use the product? So customer has said in beta testing phase test, okay, this is good, this product is good. Then they take it to their environment, and a lot of more new customers are using it. And the vendor is monitoring whether the customer really like to use the product, or are they actually thinking that the old product was better than this new one, or something like that. Then there is concept of gamma testing, which is pretty much the same as release candidate. So the software is pretty much ready there. And the question we are discussing is what should be put to next release. If some new features are found out that are needed in gamma testing, they are not built to the actual product, but the next version. Then there is a term of continuous beta. It can be continuous or continual or even perpetual beta. It's a concept where vendor does not want to release the product as complete and then improve it afterwards. So they want to stay in beta phase and bring the new improvements all the time. For example, Google Gmail was in beta state from 2004 to 2009, so 5 years it was in beta state. And actually the Inkscape vector graphic drawing program, the project was started in 2003, and the version 1.0 was released in 2020. So there were alpha, beta, and release candidates released in 2019 and 2020, but the software has been in wide use for 15 years before going alpha. This is pretty much different than if you are talking about that the alpha is internal testing, but the open source model is quite different. Then you just release the code from the beginning. But the reason to use continuous beta is not technical, it's more political. The company just decides to not to release the complete product. Then there is a thing called rolling release, where updates are frequently delivered. This is pretty common with some Linux distributions such as Arch. If you compare it with Ubuntu or Windows, they are bringing the updates basically yearly basis. Ubuntu with every 2 years new LDS comes, and with Windows it was something like 3 years, but now with Windows 10 it's actually moving a bit more towards rolling release, but it's not still rolling release. So the software package, or in this case operating system, is not tested as a whole, but there are multiple parts that are tested individually, and then it's made sure that everything works together, and you just roll new releases every time when new packages are ready. And testing is conducted continuously. And then comes the newest part, continuous integration and continuous delivery and deployment. So with continuous integration, developers merge their code to master several times a day. So you're doing programming on your own computer, your own desktop workstation. And when you think that your code is ready, then you just push it to version control, such as Git or Mercurial, to the master, and then someone else decides whether it's released already or next day or something like that. But you push your code several times a day to the master, which is very different from the traditional way where a developer develops his code, let's say a week, and then pushes it to master. So in this case, developers have a big role in on testing. And with continuous delivery, the software is ready to put in production all the time. So there is the code base is always such that it can be put to production. And with continuous deployment, the software is actually deployed automatically. So as the code base is always ready to go to the production, then it's automatically deployed. And continuous integration slash continuous delivery deployment relies heavily on automated testing. Test-driven development and automated unit testing, these are of course required when the source code master is kept so that it can be put into production all the time. And in some cases it was mentioned that more than 20% of the functional test cases can be automated, and that percent is going up. So I think that in a few years we have even more of the test cases automated. If we think about Facebook, which is producing a lot of new code and features all the time, Facebook has thousands of developers all over the globe. In 2011, they had one release to production per day. So every day, if you refresh your browser, facebook.com, every day there was a new version you were playing with. And in background, there was hand-picking process going on, that from version control from master there were features picked to release, and then this release tree was pushed to production. And in 2012 they improved so that there were two releases per day, still hand-picked. And in 2016, over 1,000 pushes were coming to the master per day. So developers were pushing new code all the time to the master, and the handpicking solution didn't scale anymore. So something new was required. Facebook is that lucky that they have 100% control over the whole web stack they can build. So they can build the delivery process as they see fit. They are updating the operating system on the server, all the server software, or all the software they are coding, so they really have the control. They can do whatever they want. The case is not with mobile applications the same, so it's not possible, because if you want to release a new version of software in Google Play, for example, then Google needs to check the software, and it takes a day or two before it can be released to customers. And if you are using your mobile phone and your Facebook client, the app would update twice a day or something, you really hate it. You don't want to use an app that updates twice a day. But with a web browser, you can have a application that in background it just keeps updating, and user doesn't even notice the thing. So in 2017, 100% of the production web servers run code deployed directly from master. So the release was not anymore used. The code was directly taken from master. Handpicking was removed, and automatic system pushes something like two new commits to production every few hours. So in a day, you could get thousands of new versions of Facebook. And the release is handled so that the new features first, they become available for Facebook employees, and then for something like 2% of users, and then all of the Facebook users get these new features. And feedback is collected automatically on all stages from various points of view. There is also some kind of a panic button. If developers find out that, oh, my code is not working, then he just presses the button, and it is then removed, and it's not brought to 100% of the Facebook users. And yeah, if problems are found, then the code is not taken away, and it is not distributed any further. And then if we think about Facebook itself, there is no such thing that just one Facebook. There are something like 10,000 different Facebooks running. Now, all the servers might not run the same Facebook, and if some developer wants to test new features, he can test it in live environment, and then there is just let's say to 30,000 people the feature is presented, so that they get a new version of Facebook. And if it's successful, if it improves the user experience or monetary things, monetization, then these features are brought to every Facebook users. And there is a lot of automated testing and continuous integration and continuous delivery involved here. So if you want to keep yourself up to date, then the continuous integration is the thing to learn. And if you are interested in Facebook, then there is this article, Continuous Deployment at Facebook and Tawanda. It's already several years old, but it describes how Facebook was working in 2016. It's worth reading. How we measure testing's success or not success. And so without measurement, one cannot tell whether something is done well or not. So you need to measure things. Measurement can be based on data collected from development, data based on work estimations, data based on coverage, measurements based on results, project status, etc. For example, how large percentage of source code do test case execute at least once? So if it's running or only 20% of the source code, then the test case cannot, based on that test case, you cannot say that, oh, the program is working very well. So then we could have a measurement, for example, how many existing test cases fail per 1,000 new lines of added code, or how many required features have been implemented in time and how many of them pass testing within first two iterations. That's about measurements. Then where are the faults hidden? They are in new code, so it's more likely to have bugs in new code than in existing one. If you are bringing new features, then there also is a higher risk that there are faults. A new technology. You change your database system or programming framework or server is updated, then these are things that might lead to problems. Or if you modify your code. So there really is not small enough change that could not break the whole program. And last minute hot fixes. Actually, this was one thing that Facebook was trying to remove when they improved their system, that there was would not be any need for hot fixes because they can break things. They might not fulfill the coding standards, and in the long run can introduce more problems than they solve. Outsourced code. So if you are utilizing code not produced in-house, you really need to make sure that it follows the company standards. New customer. That's a funny thing. So although the old customer has been using the software for a long time and here they have no complaining, you bring new customers in and the new customer finds new issues because they are using the software a bit differently. They want it to solve a bit different problems, and then there might be new issues rising. And of course, you bring a new employee to your company, then there in the beginning there might be experience and skills that are required. They are just he or she is just still a bit lacking them, and thus first commits can be dangerous. So you really need to help the new employee to become part of the developer group. A few notes, walkaways, just to take a tester someone else than the programmer. In many cases, programmer is a good tester, but then when we go up in a testing tree, so you are doing system testing, for example, then the programmer is definitely not the right guy to test. Test, do not think. So if you just think that, okay, this seems to be okay, we don't need to test it, then it probably will fail. You just test, and test. And good test can never save a bad program. If you are doing a program that tries to solve wrong problem, then even if it has been tested perfectly, which is impossible, then it cannot save the program as it is not solving the right thing. And if there is only a handful of bugs found, it really doesn't matter mean that the program is high quality. It means that the testing has not been thorough. Test now or pay later, and the later you find it, the more you pay. So if the bugs are found in the production, it will be 100 more 100 times more expensive to fix it than if they would have been found out in the requirement analysis phase. And the test phase will take longer than was thought. You're just trying to release your program on specific date, but there is still a lot of testing to be conducted, so you will then postpone the release date or something. The testing will take its time. And as a conclusion, there are different software lifecycle models. There is different testing conducted in different lifecycle phases. There are different ways to release software, and nowadays the continuous integration, continuous delivery is gaining popularity. So fast development, fast testing, fast delivery. That's one thing to improve the software development process.